Well, it's the College of Complexes. And we have tonight with us Andy Anderson, better known to the public as L.P. Anderson, the author of a lot of information, the conveyor of books on obscure and facts that have been blacked out from the media because they are contested. Contested by people for various reasons.
By the government.
And Andy will explain all about documented facts and documented reality on a range of issues. Andy is the representative of the Northwest Information Service of Palatine, Illinois. And he wants to help people learn of highly credible information sources, which can move Americans and the world toward a cleaner, greener, and more peaceful future.
Without further ado, Brown gave me an introduction, but what he didn't mention, my brother and I, we ran with eight other people from various churches. We formed the Northwest Information Council in 1983 in response to a man in the U.S. Department of Defense, the Undersecretary for Nuclear Theater Operations, a man named T.K. Jones, was in President Reagan's cabinet. And Jones was teaching business leaders, there's no problem with nuclear war as long as every American has his own shovel and can dig his own foxhole. So with enough shovels, there's no problem with nuclear war. We can launch first and win and fulfill Bible prophecy. I became interested. Is the battery on this thing dying? Or
I just put an 01 in there.
Okay, I'll try to speak into it. And I got out of the service in late 1969 as a Vietnam veteran, and I began reading everything I could get my hands on about what was going on in America, because it was obvious that I was lied to as a patriotic young person that enlisted in the military, thinking that we'd be fighting for freedom and justice and defending American values in foreign lands. That is 180 degrees out of phase from what's happening. So I've read everything I get my hands on since then on a variety of subjects, and that has evolved into my brother and I doing book reports and translations of the database produced by Censored News every year. This book comes out in October every year out of Sonoma State University. The journalism school gives you the top 25 blacked out stories of the year that would change America overnight if they were covered rather than blacked out. This is the 2015 edition. It's probably listed on that one flyer I gave you. Those two handouts are the basic core of the starting point for our talk tonight. The other thing, in 1967, there was a meeting with someone, I forget the names now, it's so long ago, I didn't write down the source, but I got started studying nuclear power when I ran across the minutes of a meeting from the Atomic Energy Commission in 1967. The people were planning on having 1,600 nuclear power plants running on American soil by the year 2000. They thought one reactor accident, one Chernobyl per 1,000 years of service would be acceptable. Except that with 1,600 reactors running, they predicted that we would have the equivalent of one Chernobyl per year on American soil. But, as the man said, the public is, by the year 2000, the United States is going to be overpopulated enough that the public is just going to have to get used to one blast a year and a few thousand dead, and 100 square miles roped off as a national sacrifice zone in exchange for cheap electricity. The people that planned nuclear power thought America could absorb one Chernobyl per year on American soil in exchange for cheap electricity. That's how fundamentally insane some of our national policies have been, you know, since 1967. So, they're, as we teach seventh graders, the universal advice to seventh graders is if you want to solve any problem, in order to solve any problem, you have to first correctly identify the solution. And so that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. On that, that list I passed out of documented facts, documented reality, there's 10 basic facts on there with the references listed on the back. And those references, incidentally, each one of them is a summary of an enormous database of evidence, like the database on cigarette smoking or the database on asbestos. This is not the opinion of one scientist doing research. It's a summary of thousands of scientists that have published thousands or tens of thousands of research papers all over the world, in other countries too, showing that, you know, these 10 facts are so heavily documented, they're not debatable in a court where you would have to present evidence and make a case to a jury. If you dispute any of these 10 in a court case, you would be laughed out of court by the jury and the judge. You know, the case would probably be dismissed. It's like trying to have a debate between someone in England from the Flat Earth Society and someone from NASA that is a former astronaut that landed on the moon. There's the database on the round Earth side is 99.9% certain now, even though the Flat Earth industry Flat Earth group in England has about 2,000 members. They're still doing research showing how the rest of us have been misled by what they call the ball earth hoax promoted by the media. So, you know, when somebody stands up at a podium like this and says, there's no such thing as global warming, or nuclear power is our savior, that person is, you know, they're in one of two categories. They're either maintaining themselves in a bubble of terrifying ignorance, just stupefying ignorance, or they're part of a group we call intellectual prostitutes that are paid to lie to us and paid to slow down the spread of knowledge so that the fossil fuel industry can continue to make trillions. I will... That white flyer I handed out has a quote. It's a quote out of this book, it's Censored News. The quote is, when a well-packaged web of lies has been sold gradually to the masses over generations, the truth will seem utterly preposterous and its speaker a raving lunatic. It was Thomas Paine also that said, you know, a long habit of not thinking a thing wrong gives it an air of superficial credibility, and anybody speaking the truth will run into the concept of you want to shoot the messenger. In other words, the old saying, shoot the messenger. Look up that quote from Thomas Paine. I forget the actual wording of it, but it's kind of the same thing as this one. And this is so appropriate because the media in America now, their job, according to how they're paid by the billionaires that own and control the media, their job on certain subjects is to maintain Americans in a state. In a state of artificial ignorance, believing that they're well informed by watching the news, and they have no idea, you know, what the reality is on several subjects. So I'll just run through this list real quick, and then I'll take 5 minutes to discuss four of these, and then we may just open the floor to discussion, and you can ask questions on any of these 10. Any of these 10 subjects here, incidentally, we could have a two-hour meeting discussing a fraction of the database that exists on these subjects. On number one, of course.
Chicken kebab.
Yes.
Mushroom bun and chicken.
That first should be a big red flag to anybody in America that is concerned about the future of our children and grandchildren. 22 veterans a day, approximately 8,000 a year, are committing suicide for a variety of reasons. Our country is the only country on the planet that has military veterans committing suicide, and these numbers are percentages. And there's a huge database on the possible reasons for that. One of them is the veterans are being drugged with antidepressants because they're not being treated for what used to be called shell shock. They call it PTSD now. And rather than treat it with compassion and other caring techniques like the veterans that came home from World War II, today the VA describes antidepressant drugs that one of the side effects is they push people toward suicide. Another reason the veterans might be committing suicide is if they come back from Afghanistan and Iraq, they've been living and working in two countries that are considered uninhabitable for humans. So the veterans coming back are so radioactively contaminated with depleted uranium dust that they can basically forget about having healthy children that aren't born with all kinds of deformities and everything else. That's one of the top 10 subjects that's been covered in censored news over the last few years. Let's have a show of hands here. Can anybody tell me what was the year that radiation experts declared Iraq and Afghanistan uninhabitable for humans? Does anybody know that? It was October of 2005, almost 10 years ago. And they've been exploding radioactive dust dispersal weapons, depleted uranium, in the hundreds of tons every year since then. It's a program to eliminate the human population living in those countries so we can run automated pipelines and automated pumping stations to control the energy supplies from the Middle East. Number two on this list, which is definitely related to number one, we're told that our soldiers are fighting for freedom. They're not. They're protecting oil supplies and everything else, because the United States, the people in the United States, are being maintained in a level of artificial energy ignorance. That is, high mileage cars that get 70 to 80 miles of the gallon, they're manufactured in other countries, and some of them are manufactured here and shipped overseas. You can't buy a high mileage car and import it into America. It's illegal under all kinds of laws for Americans to purchase high mileage cars that are sold to the other 95% of the people. Our car companies have been testing 100 mile per gallon cars since 1980. And that's in a book called Energy and War, Breaking the Nuclear Link, and in a bunch of others. Three, houses without furnaces, having extremely low $10 to $20 a month energy bills, have been built all over America and Canada since 1977. The first houses without furnaces went up in this area in 1979. The builder gave those people a certificate that says, we guarantee the house will heat for 10 bucks a month, $100 a year maximum, or we'll pay the rest for the first decade. So I was wearing a button counting down the months, 48 months, 4 years to 2013 as I was coaching the seventh graders. I was telling them, as we get to 2013, if a builder gives you a new house anywhere, if it has a furnace in it, you could really sue him for malpractice. Giving you a house with a furnace in it is the same thing as giving you a whole new video entertainment system in your house that has an 8-track tape player for music. You wonder, and if you could find a city where everybody uses 8-tracks while the rest of the country went on to CDs and iPods, what would that tell you about the media? If the media was able to maintain people in such a bubble that they would be using 25-year-old technology thinking that there's nothing else available.
You've never heard of 8-track heaven, have you?
The fourth thing on the list is solar electric hybrid cars are here now and can be easily recharged by affordable solar panels. A coach from the Science Olympiad out in Arlington Heights is converting his garage with solar panels. He's got panels up now, bank of batteries. he charges his car. He's got a Chevy Volt. He charges his car off the roof of the garage and then drives back and forth to work without using gasoline. He'll carry a couple of gallons of gasoline around in the tank as a spare for 3-4 months at a time without the engine ever coming on, unless he gets out on the tollway and has to use, you know, gas for more than 40 miles. So the Chevy Volt and the Nissan Leaf are two cars that can be charged easily with affordable solar panels on the roof right now. By this time next year, 2 years from now, say, you should see a lot of solar panels all over roofs in Chicago, because that's part of what's called the rooftop revolution. Number five, that's a generic number that is accepted and been used by solar energy analysts all over the world, energy efficiency promoters, since the middle of the 1970s, since they've been calculating how much sunlight falls on the planet every day and energy versus how much energy the human race uses every day. And so basically 10,000 times more energy falls on us as light than what we use for all forms of energy. We collect 1/10,000th of the daily solar intake with solar panels, and we can run the human race, everything, without any coal, oil, gas, or nukes. Number six on that list, this is a simple fact. You just have a 30% open mind and look at the evidence without any prejudice. Just use your common sense that you got in 7th and 8th grade science. Number six is, all 7 buildings of the old, obsolete, asbestos-filled World Trade Center complex, all 7 buildings were destroyed in one day with prepaid, prepared demolitions. Those buildings were prepared months in advance to be demolished, and they sold it to us as a terrorist event so that they wouldn't have to pay for the demolition themselves, and they wouldn't get sued by the Wall Street lawyers for contaminating the whole area with asbestos dust. The myth of 9/11, that we were attacked by crazed Muslims, is one of the all-time most successful pieces of mythology sold in broad daylight anywhere in the history of the human race. And many, many different groups across the spectrum are teaching that the myth of 9/11 is what is supporting our 1,000 military bases all over the world, so-called fighting terrorism. If we puncture the myth of 9/11, we can bring the troops home from everywhere and start spending that money in America.
You like it?
On that white flyer that I gave you,
oh, yes, excellent.
There's a quote from Martin Luther King back when he was alive. His quote was, "A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death." A very, very strong case can be made and argued now that we have long since passed that point, and the American Empire has entered a state of spiritual undeath, like a whole bunch of intellectual zombies, millions of them running around believing that we're fighting for freedom and justice in foreign lands and defending American values, when one of the top 10 stories in the censored news this year is that all 10 of the top recipients of American aid, all top 10 countries that get aid from us, all practice torture and abuse of women and children, a war on women, a war on kids. It's an incredible story. I will be giving an updated presentation of Censored News. We'll talk about the top 10 to 15 stories in this book, the 2015 edition, this October. I think it's October 24th that it's on the schedule. So if anybody wants to have an in-depth study of this book, I would encourage you to get your own copy of the Censored 2015 and bring it that night and help add to the discussion of, you know, that we'll have for 2-2.5 hours. And then take the information out to other groups that you might be part of and help move the country forward. Number seven there is another one of the subjects that is really among the top 10 most pressing issues in the world, and it's hydraulic fracturing or fracking. What are you looking for, Tim?
It's just a portal website card.
The card, oh. Tim, I have a stack of cards up here. Tim, I put them on the desk there in the central. Those are a list of cards that I use. They're called portal websites. That each website is a portal or a doorway into the other world where all the blacked out news is on that subject. There's a website, there's a couple of websites listed called virusmyth.com and Rethinking AIDS. There's one called Patriots Question 9/11. There's another one, Rocky Mountain Institute, who published this book and dozens of others over the years on the energy efficiency revolution. Can I have a show of hands here, people? Heads up. Has anybody read this book called Reinventing Fire? It's from Rocky Mountain Institute. Dennis Nelson has read it. Anybody else?
Yes, I just finished it.
You finished this book?
Yes.
Are you serious? Or are you joking?
I had just read that one on audiobook.
Reinventing Fire?
Yes, and I agree a lot with what he has to say, and it gets me more convinced about the need for nuclear power.
Now, Tim has just given us an example of how a person can be totally immune to facts long after the facts are totally undebatable.
I look at the basic fact. I look at the basic fact that E equals X squared.
Okay, this is what Bughouse Square should be like.
No, it's good. It's a good book. Good read.
Climate change, number 8 on that list, of course. There's as I've said before, I carry this book with me everywhere I go. This is one of my top five recommended books. It's called Unprecedented: Can Civilization Survive the CO2 Crisis? And if you don't have time to read the last 100 books or so that have published in the last 15 years on global warming and climate change, this book summarizes that database better than anything I've ever seen in my entire lifetime on that particular subject. In 1980, Rocky Mountain Institute published Brittle Power that summarized our energy situation, and that is still considered the classic textbook 35 years ago. This one will be considered the classic book on global warming, I think, as the knowledge spreads and more people find out what's in it. And it's loaded with solutions to our problems. Give me one sec here.
What you looking for, Andy?
I appear to have misplaced the book. I thought I had it with me. Okay, never mind. I'll just tell you what it is. Number 8, you know, climate change, global warming. There's a book, for those of you that haven't seen it, churches around the world in the Vatican are talking about it. It's called The Green Bible. An encyclical statement came down right from the Pope that said it's our Christian duty to stop burning fossil fuel and stop destroying the planet. The Pope is heavily involved in teaching and promoting that now. And the Green Bible has a picture of a green tree on the cover, and all the passages in that Bible that entrust us or encourage us to protect God's creation and stop polluting and burning fossil fuel. They're all outlined in light green, pale green ink so you can see them. So this book has a chapter in there talking about the religious response to global warming and climate change. And there's a whole chapter in there talking about what churches, forward-thinking churches all over the world are doing to try to meet the crisis in the time frame that we have to acknowledge how much time we have and what kind of action is needed. He makes a strong case that we're long past the time when we can gradually phase into solving the climate problem. Even if there were a generation of new, clean, safe nuclear power plants, the problem with climate change will be solved and completely you know, non-debatable. We will have passed the tipping point, and the oceans will be on their way to rising 60 feet before the first kilowatt of nuclear energy comes online. So nuclear power, if you study it, you'll see that spending money on any kind of central nuclear power plants actually contributes to the destruction of the environment, because it takes away money away from things that could cut down on the burning of fossil fuel very, very fast. Number nine, the nuclear accident in Fukushima. That's an ongoing disaster of biblical proportions, what they're calling an extinction level event. The radiation monitors on the West Coast, our government radiation monitors that monitor the air and water, have all been shut down by the US government. So the only monitoring that's going on is being done by private citizens and private colleges to try to collect data on the radioactive cloud that's drifting around the world from Fukushima. It's estimated that the U.S., as the cloud drifted over from the accident of Fukushima, as that cloud reached the West Coast, the infant mortality rate went up about 35%. And it's estimated that the United States has lost, we've had an excess of about 14,000 sudden infant deaths due to the cloud of Fukushima traveling around the world. And that's just the West Coast of the United States. Other countries are experiencing the same kind of disaster with infant mortality from the radiation poisoning, depending on where you live in the world. There's serious talk, we thought it was a joke, but one author was serious about saying that Japan should make a deal with Russia, where Russia would sell Japan an equal number of square miles, the square mileage of Japan itself. Let the Japanese buy unused acres in Russia and then just relocate all the people in Japan to make a new country in Russia and call it Japan 2. Because Japan itself, the whole island, is heading toward being a radioactive wasteland. Kids, school children in Tokyo have been given portable small radiation monitors to check the radiation in the water and food and what they eat for lunch and dinner. They're carrying these little monitors right with them. And Japan is making an effort to try to protect the children without telling the rest of the world what a huge disaster that is. And it's not under control yet. It won't be for a while. The tenth thing on here is one of the three. There's an orange article up here called the Golden Triangle, for anybody that wants one. Next to the myth of 9/11 and next to the myth of our soldiers fighting for freedom and justice in foreign lands is the myth that HIV was the cause of all kinds of sick people that were told they had AIDS. It turns out that there is no epidemic called AIDS. As Dr. Nancy Turner Banks wrote, what we had was a deadly virus of international greed. We had a deadly international epidemic of greed promoted by the billionaires in the pharmaceutical industrial complex, where the media has been running a two-pronged process on this. They've been promoting the idea that HIV causes AIDS on all channels, and they've been simultaneously suppressing hundreds of scientists from all over the world that have been publishing articles since 1985 for 30 years now, saying HIV is harmless. That's not the cause of what's making people sick, and you have to do research and find out what is making people sick. And other countries found that answer in 1987. They found out that the HIV test itself is bogus. It doesn't test for the virus. All the HIV test kits have been coming with an insert in the package, a legal disclaimer, so you can't sue the manufacturer in court if you get the idea you're HIV positive from taking that test. The legal disclaimer says, be alert and be aware, this test does not test for the HIV virus at all, doesn't test for or react to that virus under any circumstances. The test reacts to particles in your blood when you're sick from almost anything. So the other half of the fraud, this is a 16th anniversary edition of a book called Positively False. It just came out. It's the updated edition from 1998. Joan Shenton in England, and from Channel 4, she's her medical researcher, and the group was called Meditel. And one of the medical subjects they've been following for 30 years is the hoax and the fraud that's being perpetrated on the world about HIV and AIDS. And in this book, she summarizes, the preface is made up of 20 different contributions by the doctors who have been curing people in other countries of all the illnesses mistakenly called AIDS since 1990. 25 years ago, it was recognized by the French doctor, Dr. Luc Montagnier. He got the Nobel Prize for his early work supposedly discovering HIV, and since 1990, he has been saying that HIV is not the cause of AIDS. Other things are, and those things are treatable and curable. So if you get pneumonia, you can be treated and cured. But if you get pneumonia and let somebody give you the bogus HIV test, and you get classified as HIV positive with pneumonia, they say, well, that's a type of pneumonia that leads to AIDS, so here, start taking the AIDS medicines, the antiviral drugs, and it'll stretch out your life. The other half of the fraud, where doctors are being sued now for wrongful death, is that the early HIV medicine, the antiviral drug called AZT, was capsules that had a fatal chemotherapy drug. What Nancy Turner Banks in her book and several others, the doctors have called that chemical rat poison for humans. They said Burroughs Wellcome, when they put that drug on the market in 1987, their internal documents showed, just like the internal documents of the tobacco industry, they knew their product was a killer. Burroughs Wellcome, which is now GlaxoSmithKline, said, we're going to kill two birds with one stone. We're going to make billions and billions of dollars on the sales of this drug because people will spend anything to stretch out their life a year or two where they're supposedly looking for a vaccine or a cure. And so we're going to make billions, and we're going to get rid of as many gay people as fast as possible, because if they take it according to doctor's orders four times a day, it will be 100% fatal. There'll be no survivors. And there weren't. 30,000 a year died taking that medicine, and there's a book on it called AIDS, Poisoned by Prescription. There's dozens of books talking about the fraud of how so many people died in the media. Once again, Censor News talked about it in 1995. These people were being poisoned by the AIDS doctors, and the media was telling us over and over again, another person has just died of AIDS. They had all kinds of illnesses. But, you know, tuberculosis, cervical cancer, pneumonia, several different kinds of bacterial illnesses. All these illnesses have been around for decades. Okay. And in 1984, it was decided to lump these illnesses together and start telling the country we had an AIDS epidemic. So for those of you, if you're over 60 years old, you probably remember the AIDS quilt, where they were making big quilt panels for the people that were dying of AIDS. The media did a tremendous job in this country promoting the myth of the AIDS epidemic. And that's where that quote on that white page comes through, where, you know, Preston James says, you know, when a well-packaged web of lies has been sold gradually to the masses over generations, the truth will seem utterly preposterous. And as speaker, a raving lunatic. So when people come out and talk about the truth, the actual reality of what these scientists have known, and how big the database is, any speaker that tries to talk about that gets almost instantly attacked by people in the audience who, for some reason, have never heard of it and can't handle the truth. It's what we call a Catholic Church syndrome. You know, if you go into a church on Sunday, if the people didn't know that Father O'Malley was abusing their kids for the last 12 years, about half of the congregation will say, you're slandering the man. They will attack the speaker. Get out of here. That can't be true. The other half of the congregation, however, says, if a shred of this is true, just a tiny amount, then we have a legal, moral, and ethical obligation to take action and protect the kids. How many kids could have been saved how many kids could have been saved from the abuse of Bill Cosby if people had spoke out and not covered that up way early on? The latest count is something like 40 women that have come forward and given affidavits saying that they were abused by Cosby. Abuse of all kinds goes on. Our soldiers are dying in large numbers day after day, year after year, because we refuse as a country to face the simple fact that they're out there killing women and children with our tax dollars. That's what's going on. Our military is the largest military industrial killing machine that the world has ever seen. And if you try to mention that anywhere, people say, well, you're not respecting the troops. I say, let's tell the troops the truth and bring them home. Let's admit that we don't need foreign oil, that the only reason our troops are being used to protect foreign oil sources is we're being maintained in a bubble of incredible ignorance on how much energy we need and where we can get that energy. So for 10 or 15 minutes, I'm going to talk about briefly on this other flyer. You can get one. There's a slightly larger write-up. We've been asking the question. Rocky Mountain Incident has been asking the question since 1980. In 1980, they published this book called Energy and War, Breaking the Nuclear Link. And they asked the question, how much energy is needed to get the job done? That is, if you use energy in the most efficient manner, how much energy would we need as a country? He published a chart in here with all kinds of estimates in 1972, 1974, 1976, 1978. And Amory was estimating that we could use 120 quadrillion BTUs. He was considered insane. We'll never use that little. The government crazies were estimating that we'd use 190 quads, you know, by the year 2000. Well, they collected estimates. Every 2 years, the estimates came down as the knowledge was spreading that new refrigerators use less, new lights use less, a better insulated house uses less. 100 mile per gallon cars would use a quarter as much as a 25 mile per gallon car. By 1980, the government estimates were now lower than what they considered Amory Lovins insane for just 8 years earlier. That's how fast the idea changed that how much energy would we need to get the job done. When we opened our first teaching seminar in 1980, we asked the question, if you have proper materials and use energy properly, how much energy does it take to get the job done? I showed you a minute ago what ceiling fans normally have wooden blades and a heavy metal hub, and they use 35 to 40 watts. But if you had proper lightweight materials and a proper lightweight motor, how little energy would you need to make a ceiling fan? Did anybody here attend one of my demonstrations back in the 80s and see what a portable ceiling fan looks like? We made this up as an example for an executive who has everything. You've got four Japanese blades that unfold. You can carry this in your coat pocket or your attaché case when you go to work. When you get there, you could carry a portable fan with you to almost any office and set it up within a couple of minutes and get it running. Show you what this looks like. This is an example of an object that will do a job for you that can be run on a couple of watts of solar electricity connected from a solar panel on the roof. There's a picture of a portable ceiling fan that will give you a gentle breeze. If you can hang it over your desk at work and take it with you anywhere.
Fix that blade you got there.
Everybody see that? That'll give you a gentle breeze, and there's other. There's a whole generation of portable fans that run on. Here's a little one. Here's an example. This fan uses about 2 watts. It's little blades. This is a two to three watt fan. It says 3 watts on it, right? So you have little blades. One of the things Rocky Mountain Institute teaches that big blades moving slow will move as much air as a little blade moving fast. So if you want to cut down the total energy, if you're using a fan to dry grain in a silo out in a farm or something, if you have big blades moving slow, you cut the horsepower by 75 or 80% compared to what a smaller fan would take using more horsepower to run the blade faster. This one, incidentally, this is a whole new generation of little 5-volt batteries that can be charged on all kinds of solar cells and taken with you. We'll just let those run for just a minute. Here's an example of a portable solar cell that you can take on a camping trip, fold it up in your backpack. You unfold it and you can hang it from a tree or point it toward the sun. You plug a little, it's automatically, it puts out five volts, about 5 watts of electricity. It will charge your cell phone battery or a portable battery like this. Solar energy is intermittent. So when the sun is shining, you charge portable batteries, and then you can run appliances like what you see here, or what you see here on, this is a portable 12 volt battery that can be charged off of solar cells this size or bigger. And you have a battery with an inverter, and you can carry that thing anywhere, plug in 110 volt appliances. Here's a light bulb. There's an old Edison incandescent bulb that goes back 100 years, basically. That bulb, that's a 25 watt bulb, and it converts about 10% of the electricity slops out of the bulb as light. The other 90% of the electricity is converted to raw heat. It's like a heat lamp in a bulb, and 10% of the electricity comes out of the bulb as light. This bulb is a replacement. I just got this at IKEA 2 days ago. There's a whole generation of LEDs coming out. That bulb there is a 3-watt bulb. It's like 3.5 watts. My connection is a little bit loose there. But that 3-watt, 3.5-watt bulb replaces that 25-watt bulb. You cut your electric consumption by 85%. Here's an example of a LED floodlight. This bulb, I believe, let me take a look real quick. Yeah. This bulb is a replacement for almost like a 100-watt light bulb, between 75 and 100 watts, and it uses 17 watts and it's dimmable. This bulb is dimmable. Everybody see that, how bright that thing is? That uses 17 watts. It'll effectively replace a 100-watt incandescent light bulb that used to be one of the old current suckers. So you can, these things are dim, so you can dim that thing down to about 6 or 8 watts for just the amount of light that you need. And you don't need to waste a whole bunch of energy. You know, if you have this thing in a lamp like this, 5 or 6 watts in a reflector will give you a good reading lamp at night. All of these things can be easily run off of solar panels on the roof.
I had those in my place and they all burned out.
Charlie, who has got the heckling technique down to a fine polished art over the years, has just said, I had those things in my apartment and they all burned out. What he's talking about is the squirrely compact fluorescents that had defective ballasts in them, not the new LEDs that I'm showing you here. Well, if you had one of these, it wouldn't have burned out. You bought one of the ones that was slightly not as good as some of the ones that have come out lately. Just like any technology, the early models, you know, they're ironing the bugs out consistently. Look at the early cell phones we had compared to what we have now. Does anybody remember, let's have a show of hands, does anybody remember the floppy disk drives in computers? Anybody remember floppy disks?
Still got one.
And how much more memory and performance do we have in the new high-efficiency disk drives and even the non-disk hard drives? It's 100 to 1,000 times more storage capacity, and they're faster. You know, the things get better and better over time. So if we use technology like this, we could bring the troops home from everywhere tomorrow and start spending that money in our own country. It takes $2.1 million a year to keep a troop in Afghanistan. If you brought that one troop home and gave them a Harvard education, you'd have enough money left over to give away 43 hybrid cars. Give away cars to people that need a car, an efficient car to get back and forth. If we saved $1 trillion a year that we're pouring down the military rat hole, we could build and distribute technology like this that would push our country toward a total solar revolution where we don't use any coal, oil, gas, or nukes by 2030. In 15 years, we could be clear of fossil fuels entirely. That's what's possible if the public reaches critical mass and pushes our elected representatives to do something constructive rather than continue to play their role as highly paid intellectual prostitutes taking money from the billionaires. For those of you that don't know, we can now brag about our Senate and Congress. We have the smoothest running, best financed intellectual whorehouse on the planet. There's no debate on that. It's a whorehouse. And they used to call those cash contributions bribes. It used to be illegal to bribe somebody for their vote. Today they call it campaign contributions.
Right.
And it's dark money. It's in the Supreme Court has ruled it's completely legal to buy and sell politicians just like you would buy and sell gold or silver futures or pork bellies. And this is our country. The United States stands alone. We're number one in not having affordable education or affordable health care for the citizens. We are number one in spending more money on the military-industrial complex than the next 20 countries on the planet combined. We're number one in a variety of issues where if common sense prevailed with the technology we have, we could transform the nation. So the first step, we teach seventh graders again. The first step is, in order to solve any problem, you have to correctly identify what the problem is and then correctly identify the solution. So with the few minutes we have left in the presentation, I think on these documented facts and documented reality, who from the audience, take a show of hands, who would like to have a 2-minute presentation of the database on any one of these? Any one of these 10 more interesting than what we've already talked about? Or
you passed up number 7, by the way.
I missed number 7?
Yes, seven.
A hydraulic fracturing, there's another one that is being completely undercovered and underreported by the mainstream media. Fracking causes earthquakes and destroys the water tables. There's no debate on that, and the companies that are doing fracking are doing it for the reasons that they destroy the water tables. They're developing the next gold rush is considered the market for clean water. If you destroy the underground aquifers and the wells on which farmers depend for clean water, and citizens destroy their wells, then they have to either buy or import clean water, or they have to sell the land for pennies on the dollar to the billionaire predators. That's where we are. And the book Unprecedented that I held up earlier by David Ray Griffin talks about that. There's a huge amount of evidence in there about what's known about fracking and how the media is just flat out covering it up. On each of these 10 subjects, the reality that would change America overnight is being intentionally suppressed and covered up by the billionaire-owned media. And that's where we are today. So there's solutions to all 10 of these things we talked about. The solutions are readily available with the spread of knowledge that is here and no longer debatable on any circumstances or any conditions. At some point, the evidence just becomes so overwhelming that you can't debate it anymore. And that's where we are. That's why these things are listed as facts. They're not opinions. They're not theories of what happened. These things are facts. And here's one of our regulars is laughing because he's an example of another person who simply can't face the reality on a certain specific subject. In a group like this, what you'll find is several people will say, "Oh, that, I agree with that 100%. But I object to this one." And then over on this side, you'll find people will say, "Oh yeah, I agree with all these things, but this other subject here, that can't be real. I object to that." It's because when you first hear something that goes against a myth that you've been believing for a long time, it's hard to face the reality. The myth is comfortable. People live in a comfortable bubble of mythology, and it's just like a wife that goes to work every day and is living under the assumption that her unemployed brother that's living with her is taking care of her 10-year-old daughter when she's gone to work. And when she finds out, a neighbor says there's evidence that he's been molesting your daughter. Initially, the woman just can't face the reality of that. It's just too bad to believe. I don't want to believe that. So how many issues of child abuse, all kinds of problems, could be solved, and a lot of pain and suffering in the population could be prevented at the source if people would step through the psychological barrier and face the reality on the earliest possible inclination that the evidence might be real? And that's how I look at it. I'm from the half that says if a fraction of that evidence is true, we have a moral, legal, and ethical obligation to try to make things better. There's one quote.
Where is it?
In this book, there's a retired L.A. Los Angeles police officer that became an investigator, and he helped form a group called the Office for Medical and Scientific Justice, OMSJ. And what they do is they have a group of lawyers. They defend people in court who have been convicted or accused of putting people at risk because they had sex with them without telling them that they were HIV positive. And what this law firm proves in court is that, number one, there's no way to tell a person was HIV positive because the test is totally bogus. And number two, even if they were HIV positive, it doesn't do any harm to expose somebody to it, because HIV has been known to be completely harmless, basically, since 1985. They're proving that in court cases, just like the court cases proved that the asbestos industry and the tobacco industry had been lying to us for 30 years. So the subject, you know, the problem of AIDS can be considered asbestos on steroids. And the lawsuits are coming up through the courts completely disproving the myth that we had an HIV/AIDS epidemic. So the future is a lot brighter for young people. Tell young people what they're being taught in Europe and other countries. You're not growing up under this big cloud of death called AIDS. You don't have to worry about catching it because it's not contagious or sexually transmitted. And the only danger you have is your medical records to allow some malpracticing doctor or clinic to give you an HIV test in the first place.
What?
So the second phase of the AIDS epidemic is starting now. They want to give one pill a day to healthy young people that are still HIV positive, but they might be at risk. The Affordable Care Act will pay for preventive medicine. If you're on Medicaid or low income, your child can be used as a human ATM machine. You sign the child up to take one pill a day for the rest of their life to keep them safe, even though they're not HIV positive now, and that one pill a day, we're being told, will protect them if they ever get exposed to HIV. And that one pill a day costs $1,350 a month, $17,000 a year. So there's hundreds of billions of dollars at stake on that myth alone. There's trillions of dollars at stake on the myth of 9/11. Trillions of dollars at stake on the myth of our military fighting for freedom and justice and protecting foreign oil sources because we need foreign energy, which we don't. So that concludes the main body of the talk, and I guess we'll start with questions and answers now.
Okay. All right. Andy, I'm kind of interested in the story about how you came to your beliefs. In the most recent movie that Robert Stone did called Pandora's Promise, he said that the best way to bring somebody around to your point of view in looking at the evidence is to tell them a story and then let them take a look at the facts. Was this a similar case with you, or was it something that came to you or had a preconceived notion on? What is it that caused you to believe the way you do, not just, I mean, on a personal level?
Oh, the question was, what caused it for me to believe the way I do and look at the media the way I do? It started one night when I was in Vietnam late. Our base was under attack, and we were in a bunker with radios listening to the communication between the helicopters and the battalion headquarters. We were just north of Saigon, and our base was being shelled with rockets and mortars in the middle of the night, and our helicopters were up there, and they, in the dark, it's about 1 o'clock, and they could see where the rockets and mortars were being fired into our base. So they had to ask for permission to fire upon the enemy positions. For a variety of reasons, you had to get permission to fire. And the gunships were told, permission denied, permission denied. And in a few minutes, the rocket mortar attack was over. A few dozen of those things were fired into our bases. Most of them went off harmlessly. Nobody was really injured. They just woke us up every 2 days. But I talked to a friend of mine who was a helicopter crew chief. The next day I said, what's this deal about not being able to fire on the enemy when you can see where they are and they're firing rockets into our base? And he said, oh, well, we met our kill quota for the day earlier in the day. We can only kill so many, and then we come back to the PX and have beer and pizza. And then we go out the next day and kill a few more. He said, if we were given the permission to fire on the enemy wherever we found them, the war would be over in a couple of weeks. So the Vietnam War was not a war. It was a controlled military operation to spread out the action of the military to defend and protect oil sources and other resources in that part of the world. That one experience set me on the road to reading about things that weren't being reported in the media. And then shortly thereafter, I heard about the Atomic Energy Commission saying we can absorb one Chernobyl per year on American soil. And then later at 83, with enough shovels, as long as everybody has his own shovel and can dig his own foxhole, there's no problem with nuclear war. These were not jokes. I mean, these people weren't expressing a substantiated opinion that had any basis in science. These people were fundamentally insane, and they had high positions in the U.S. government. We've been dealing with fundamentally insane billionaires running our country, since 1983. And that's why today our country stands alone. We're number one in not having any affordable education, higher education for our citizens. We're number one. Only modern country in the world doesn't have affordable universal health care for all its citizens. So that's why Clive Baker said, on his subject, he said, once you understand the magnitude of the myth and the sham, it is really impossible not to feel obligated to expose and correct it. It's basic human nature. If you were raised with a concept of having a conscience and being able to tell right from wrong, once you can see that a wrong is being committed, you have... You want to shut that off?
No, I just want to play it properly.
Yes, after you.
Oh. So once you understand that there's a problem, you have a moral, a universal moral imperative to try to do something about it. And that's how things get better on a variety of subjects.
Next question?
Yeah, Andy, I looked up this HIV/AIDS thing, and the conclusion I came across, was that people with HIV/AIDS were wasting money at least 53% to 63% on quackery herbal concoctions. And that was the problem. And the secondary thing is, are you relying on this book written in 1998?
Oh, Charlie asked if I'm relying on a book written in 1998. No, the book published, the first edition of this published in 1998, summarize the database that has become 10 times larger today. What Charlie is referring to is government there's all kinds of articles put out by the U.S. government promoting the idea that HIV causes AIDS. But there's no proof, there are no documents that you can take into court and prove in court that HIV causes any kind of illness or that AIDS is infectious or contagious. There's all kinds of studies that have been done that are not reported by the U.S. that are reported around the world. Studies showing that a husband or a wife that lives with somebody that has supposedly AIDS, that person, that their mate living with them, they're not getting infected. It's not an infectious syndrome at all.
They said Illinois ranks 9th of people getting the disease. It's like 55,000 cases.
Charlie says, this is the problem.
They're making this up?
They're making it up. What they're saying is Illinois has 55,000 cases. Yes, we have 55,000 cases of people that had pneumonia or tuberculosis or something. They were given the bogus HIV test and told they had HIV/AIDS when really they had pneumonia or tuberculosis or something else. I forget what one scientist, it's been repeated by others, he said, how big would the AIDS epidemic be if all the flu cases in the wintertime, if all those flu cases were counted every year as part of the AIDS epidemic? The AIDS epidemic would look enormous. So they don't give the HIV test to people that have flu regularly because they know it will test positive and it's bogus. So when you first hear about this and what's been reported around the world, for many people, it's a big shock. It was for me when I began to realize how big the iceberg of evidence is. And there's a bunch of doctors with Nobel Prize credentials all over the world, thousands of them, that are contributing to the database that's being used in other countries.
The database is from 1998.
No, it isn't, Charlie. Quit heckling, Charlie. This database is from 2015.
No,
so if you remember Frank used to say, you got to pull it out and air it out. You got to pull your head out of the clouds and let it see the light of day.
You both are arguing the wrong point. The point is that how do you get the public to understand what the real situation is? And neither one of you are addressing that.
The question is, how do you get the public to understand what the situation is? Yeah. The quote is on the page I handed out.
No.
What we teach seventh graders. You have to look at the evidence. If you're not willing to look at the evidence, then you live in a bubble of mythology. That's what we have. STDs, sexually transmitted diseases, are completely different from what's being called HIV/AIDS. Or some of the STDs are being classified as AIDS when they're not. They're STDs. And those things are treatable and curable with various kinds of antibiotics. Question over here?
Yeah, just a moment. I'd like for people to understand that your interjection should be followed by a question mark, not
a speech.
Not a speech.
Yeah. Okay.
Also, if you want to be recognized, raise your hand and I'll do that.
Okay.
Now, Carl Sweat had his hand up first.
Okay, this portable solar little package thing, how much is that and how much are like those light bulbs that you had?
Oh, these high efficiency light bulbs are $3 to $4. And one of these bulbs, you know, that other bulb. The question is, turn this thing off now.
And how much is that?
This bulb, where was it? One question, you have to keep in mind, these things come with inserts in the package. A bulb like this costs about $12 from Costco or some of the other stores. It's a dimmable LED that'll last 25,000 hours. Over the life of this bulb, it'll save $150 to $200 on the electric bill.
Is it something you could screw into a regular outlet?
Yes.
Yeah.
$8.99 at lightbulbs.com.
All these bulbs come with regular sockets or candelabra sockets. There's hundreds of different sizes and shapes. This is simply a portable demonstration, a portable working model of larger solar cells. You can take this out camping. It's aimed at people that want to charge their cell phone on a camping trip if they're out in the middle of nowhere for 3 days.
Like,
this was $29.
It's available now?
So yeah, this is available for a little company called Harbor Freight, and online, the Sharper Image, all kinds of things like that. And you can get one of these things, a little solar charger, for about $30.
Google it online. I just found it. Lightbulbs.com. The very thing, $8.99. Portable solar panels, $23 from Amazon.com.
Yeah, as Tim would say, these things are available from Amazon, they're available online. There's literally hundreds of different sizes and shapes of light bulbs for virtually every need. Another question?
Andy. Look, I was looking at your references here on the back of your sheet, documented facts, documented reality, and I guess here that this is where you're getting your information from about these so-called facts over here on the other side, and.
Don has a question about references.
No. Let me just finish. Let me ask.
Did you want to make a speech or ask a question?
No. I'd like to ask a question if I could do so without being interrupted.
Well, what's good for the goose is good for the gander, Tom. You interrupt me half the time with bullshit.
No, I
want to know if you've got a valid question this time.
Well, first of all, I would like to just respectfully ask that the moderator enforce the one fool at a time rule.
Ask your question.
Right, and then right now, look. How do you know these guys aren't full of shit?
Which are you looking at? All
of your references. How do you know David Ray Griffin isn't a fraud? How do you know? How do you know he's not lying to you?
Okay, the question is, how do you know David Ray
Kirkland? Or any of these people?
Is because their literature, their books, their studies are backed by hundreds of other scientists that have published peer-reviewed. There's a thing called peer review in the scientific community. That's how science moves forward. You publish a theory or an experiment or something, and other scientists duplicate it, or, you know, if you're publishing forensic evidence, per se, other people investigate and they come to the same conclusion. That's the scientific method. And all of these references that I've listed here are basically summaries of a large body of peer-reviewed, scientifically solid material. That's how you know that things are scientifically solid, rather than if somebody's full of shit. So I hope that answers this question.
Okay.
No.
Next.
Tim Bolger.
Oh, I already had one. Was just saying.
Do you have another one?
Actually, yes. What do you consider the best way to bring a person around? You know, like, say, a guy like myself, right? I'm reading this stuff. I'm looking at all the evidence. I'm reading what I'm doing and judging for myself a little bit more. I'm kind of curious, what would be the best technique for me to look at to come around to your views?
Tim was asking, what is the best technique to learn something that is going to change your viewpoint, to come around to a viewpoint that at first seems hard to believe or impossible to believe?
And what kind of mindset should you have?
There is Professor Griffin's friend, another professor, told him, he says, David, you don't need an open mind to understand this. You need a 30% open mind and a 7th grade education. The hard part is you have to make up your mind that you're going to have an open mind for a few minutes and step through the psychological barrier that has prevented you from looking at the evidence up until now. When you live in a bubble of mythology, you're living in the bubble on this side of the barrier. If you step through the barrier into the other world where all the blacked out news is and the reality, then the reality, as he said, the reality on 9/11 or the reality on AIDS is very easy to understand if you step through the psychological barrier of denial and look at the evidence. You have to ask yourself, it's a personal decision. You have to decide one day, I'm going to step through the barrier and just look at the evidence with an open mind and see if it makes any sense. Many people have done that on 9/11. They asked one question, and the people that have made documentaries and everything else, they said, well, I used to believe the official story until I asked one question, and I found the answer to that question, and my life just got sucked right down the rabbit hole. I got sucked down the rabbit hole to where all the official evidence is completely buried by the mainstream media. On many of these pieces of mythology, that's how it looks. Initially, you have to keep an open mind and look at the first documented fact that you can accept. Find a fact that you can start with from square one, and then find another fact you can build on it. And it becomes easier after time to realize that these scientists, many of these scientists have 30 years, 40 years experience and credibility in these fields, and they are risking their lives and careers by speaking out. There's a total war on whistleblowers in this country. There's many of these subjects that we talked about tonight would be grounds for dismissal of any reporter on television or radio that tries to talk about these things on the air. It's grounds for instant dismissal, and that book called Into the Buzzsaw describes what happened to 18 Pulitzer Prize winners the day that they tried to report something that was taboo or radioactive that the billionaires didn't want us to know about. So decide that you're going to just suspend all belief, everything you've known, and just start looking at the evidence with an open mind. And that's how you learn. Anybody else?
Somebody else over here, was it Dennis or Gene?
Gene.
I don't know much about cars, so I think you said that there are cars that go 100 miles on a gallon of gas in other countries. have they snuck some of these in, and have you personally seen one of these cars, or do you, is your car go 100 miles?
No, my car gets about 35 miles to the gallon. No, I haven't seen any of these 100 mile per gallon prototypes in America, because 100 mile per gallon cars can't be sold in America. They can be high mileage cars can be manufactured here and shipped to Europe or Japan or other countries, but they are not for sale on American roads. I have a friend that tried to, I think it was, he was working through somebody that worked for Ford, and he said, well, you're an employee there, you know, can you arrange for me to buy one of these cars that shipped to Europe? He says, oh, no, it's they're not for sale in America. We're being maintained in a state of artificial dependency, high oil consumption per week, because the billionaires who run the oil companies want to take a percentage of our income each week. Rocky Mountain Institute talked about Volkswagen. Volkswagen was famous for having a 98 mile per gallon diesel rabbit, diesel powered rabbit that they were testing in 1980. So the current world record for experimental vehicles is something like, 9,000 miles to a gallon of gas with exotic, I think Volkswagen is actually testing a prototype now that gets 167 miles to the gallon. So there's, they've known how to make, roadworthy, crash-worthy 100 mile per gallon vehicles that would be affordable. They've known that since 1980. Okay, Charlie?
Yes. Yeah, according to your literature in the Northwest Information Service, the human race is not alone, and we've been dealing with aliens for 50 years. Where are they from?
Charlie asked one of the flyers we published in 1997, one of the, it's this blue flyer here. Jim Mars published a book called Alien Agenda. And the book wasn't about aliens, it was about the 50-year cover-up of our government and others interacting with alien races. And now, as people are carrying cell phones, the Pope put out an encyclical statement about 4 years ago saying it's okay now for devout Catholics to accept the fact that the human race is not alone, that we're being visited by other races. Because people are using their cell phones to film these landings up close and personal all over the world. The CIA had a program in 1988. They were trying to keep track of the other four civilizations that were visiting and interacting with us. He said, counting the human race, there's at least five of us out here interacting between the Earth, the Moon, and Mars, especially the Moon. As telescopes have gotten better and better, many astronomers are reporting that if you go out into a place like the desert or someplace away from streetlights with a good portable telescope worth just a few thousand dollars, you can watch the activity on the Moon, things moving back and forth, structures. The Moon is not uninhabited, and that's what Jim Mars wrote in 1997.
So the Pope wrote an encyclical that we shouldn't regard aliens as evil minorities?
Well, I'm not sure he said that. All he said was, God created other races, and since you devout Catholics are filming these things, we as the church can't maintain any kind of credibility claiming that God created us and there's nobody else. The evidence is overwhelming, is being filmed all over the world. Other countries are opening their military reading rooms to provide, let people watch the military files to see what they've been looking at and experiencing. The military have, good films of the jets, following UFOs, filming them as they've hovered over nuclear missile bases around the world. There's many cases of nuclear missile silos that have been disabled by a blue beam of light from some kind of alien spacecraft. This is totally blacked out by our media because they're superior to our Air Force. They're superior to the Russians, too. There's nothing we can do about it. They're not unfriendly. And so they have, the reason that that subject is not covered is the transportation, the energy they use has nothing to do with coal, oil, gas, or nukes. King Kong on Earth would lose trillions of dollars in fossil fuel and nuclear energy if we were allowed to use alien electromagnetic anti-gravity technology that's, you know, hundreds of years ahead of what we have here on Earth. That's the big sticking point.
Somebody else have a question? Yes,
why don't we let these two go and then we should get the rebuttals?
Okay, you showed.
How much time do we have?
It's 8:01 now.
With fan and light, and those do not use all the bulk of the energy that we have. I mean,
what's your question?
What do you do about major uses of energy, like appliances, like the refrigerator, microwave, toaster, television?
Okay, is it Janet?
Yes.
Janet has a good question. She said, what do you do about the energy consumption of major appliances? As you replace an appliance, you get a new one that uses a fourth as much electricity. Refrigerators, new refrigerators, use only 25% as much as a 15-year-old box. Efficient glass and insulation in a new house can take the place of a furnace. Houses without furnaces have been built all through Chicago and all across Canada and Western states since 1987. You spend the furnace money on walls and windows, extra insulation and extra window glass, then you can heat the house with something the size of a toaster or hair dryer. You cut the heat load requirement by 90%. And with proper usage of every kind of appliance you can think of, if you get a properly efficient new model, it will use half to a quarter as much electricity as an older one that we take for granted. And we realize not everybody can just change everything in their house all at one time. People are changing things as they wear out. But the first thing you can change is your light bulbs. The light bulbs are the absolute best rate of return on your money now for saving electricity, because these kind of bulbs used to be $20, $30 a bulb, and now they're $8, $10 a bulb. And you can get a package of six bulbs, it's for $20. It'll say on the package, this group of bulbs will save you $540 on your ComEd bill over the life of the bulbs. They're a tremendous rate of return on the money. And insulation and weather stripping around the cracks, doors and windows, that's another thing that pays back very fast. So the average person can cut their utility usage about in half easily if they want to, and they can phase down 75% over a 2 or 3 or 4 year period. Does that answer your question mostly?
Yeah, except I've done that and I've gotten new replacements and it hasn't changed the energy.
You're talking about electricity or gas?
Electricity.
ComEd has been quietly raising electric rates as we've gone more efficient.
I mean, because I'm sure you gave me a new refrigerator, mm-hmm. That's supposed to be energy saver and all that.
What you have to look at on your electric bills is look at the total kilowatt hour usage compared with 10 years ago. ComEd is charging almost 15 cents a kilowatt hour now, 16 cents to people that live in apartments and small users because of the meter fee went up. So as we've gotten more efficient, they're making a greater and greater profit per kilowatt hour to keep their profits up. So you have to look at your consumption today compared to what it was 10 years ago. I'll bet you find it's a third less. With the refrigerator, it should be 50% less for just that one appliance.
Yes, Kevin.
I believe you said that AIDS was misdiagnosed. The real cause, it was really the flu and other viruses, I guess. There was a high mortality rate among those who were supposed to have AIDS, rates that are not typically caused by the flu. How do you deal with that?
Did you hear the earlier part when I talked about this, or did you come later?
Well, I heard you say.
Okay, the question was, the question was why were people with supposedly flu, why they were dying of AIDS? Well, the people that had the certain kinds of flu or pneumonia were given the bogus HIV test, and they were told they had AIDS when they didn't. They had an illness that could have been treated and cured with ordinary antibiotics or something, but the reason they died is they were given a fatal chemotherapy drug and prescribed to take that poison four times a day for the rest of their lives to spread out, you know, extend their life. It's considered the largest, costliest, most embarrassing medical fraud and malpractice in human history. 30,000 people a year that we were told were dying of AIDS were dying of the symptoms of the fatal chemotherapy poison that produced all their AIDS symptoms, and the doctors cheerleaded these people right into their graves. So, the literature is full of examples of people that went to Europe or Canada, and the doctor said, forget about taking your AIDS medicines. You don't have AIDS, you have pneumonia. You know, the test is bogus. See, in other countries, they would tell you that. Other countries have a not-for-profit medical system, so it's profitable to try to cure people rather than to make as much money as you can off of a person that's selling their house and all their belongings to shovel money to the pharmaceutical industry in the last moments of their life. It's a crime, a federal crime, international crime of epic proportions. And the database on it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger every year. But to somebody that lost somebody, a loved one that was told died of AIDS, it's a very big shock to learn that your loved one didn't die of AIDS, that they were poisoned by an AIDS doctor.
Okay. Dennis Nelson.
Danny, always enjoy your presentations. Let's get back to shale gas and oil fracking for a minute. National Public Radio, NPR, has biased pro-fracking news coverage and runs pro-fracking ads. Isn't this a part of the problem with the news media?
Dennis asked, are the pro-fracking ads part of the problem with the news media? He's absolutely correct. The pro-fracking ads saying that the evidence isn't all in or that fracking is safe, they're using what's called the tobacco strategy. After the evidence is overwhelming on something and it's not debatable, you pay people to go on the air and just flat out lie to us. They're intellectual prostitutes that are paid to lie and create doubt. And Charles Ferguson's book, Predator Nation, has a whole chapter in there on the ivory tower about people from different industries. The oil and gas industry are paying these professors to produce studies saying that fracking doesn't cause any kind of harm. They're creating doubt to slow down and give cover to the politicians who are also on the payroll for the oil companies. Does that answer your question?
Yeah,
they're just flat out lying to us, and it's a strategy. They're not expressing an unsubstantiated opinion. They're lying, and we have to, language matters.
And normally NPR should be a credible source, and it isn't right now.
No, NPR and PBS are not credible sources at all. Yeah. They're corporate sponsored. Yeah.
Well said.
Okay,
very brief. I don't want to be on camera.
Okay,
thank you. So what I tried to say, when I was in Russia, we studied Tungus meteorite, you know, Tungus in Siberia, like some piece of meteorite came and exploded in Siberia. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, you're talking about the big explosion in 1908?
Right.
Some kind of a huge explosion in 1908.
So my question is...
What's the question?
So my question is to you, what do you think, just to you, your opinion? We're talking about Chernobyl, radioactive explosion, blah, blah, blah. You think it's some kind of maybe, just maybe connection? And my another question, very quick. If some source of energy from this meteorite are still maybe somehow leaking or a little bit like some kind of energy from this meteorite?
You're asking if some sort of energy is leaking out or radiation from some accident somewhere? Well, there are accidents all over the world. Well, there's been a lot of research and study about that accident in 2008. It was a huge blast, you know, in Russia that they thought maybe it was either a meteorite that came in and impacted or an alien spacecraft that had made an atomic explosion long before we had atomic power in Earth. But I haven't studied it that much, so I can't give a credible opinion on that.
Another possibility is antimatter. I'm just saying that's
some scientists think it was some kind of antimatter explosion from an antimatter propulsion system in an alien spacecraft. Because they have been having accidents and crafts exploding and crashing here on Earth-wide soil over the last 60 years or so.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. We should head to rebuttals now.
If it's time for rebuttals, I'd like to have a show of hands of those who have rebuttals to make. Some sort of comment was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Go about 5 minutes.
I think that, of course, our speaker will have the final rebuttal. So, that's
5 minutes.
5 minutes.
Okay.
Up to 5 minutes.
I'll give a quick signal when you got 1 minute left.
Okay. Look to Tim Bolger for a signal when you're speaking.
All right, let's thank our speaker. Jim, you know how to run the clock, right?
What?
Yeah.
Okay.
You might want to come up here.
Yeah.
Okay. For yourself.
Okay.
You get in line.
All right, Ed, we're ready, Jim?
Yeah.
Okay. First off, my name is Tim, and I agree with Andy about a lot of stuff, particularly about the people who believe lies, who believe in myths. Unfortunately, though, I think that Andy and his cohort crowd believe a lot of myths. I just recently watched a movie. It was by Robert Stone called Pandora's Promise. And it was one of the best documentaries I've seen about anti-nuclear environmentalist activists becoming pro-nuclear once they started looking at the evidence of nuclear power and the simple fact that when what Robert Stone had said was that you cannot condemn people for what they believe in because they've obviously looked at the evidence, they believe in it, and it does take an open mind to take a look at various types and forms of evidence. I myself, about 2 or 3 years ago, came to the conclusion that wind and solar aren't going to be enough power to change the planet from climate change, and that the only real viable alternative we have right now is nuclear power. Even with the inefficient light water reactors that we're using right now, it constitutes some 20% of electricity production in the United States compared to renewables, which are like 0.05. Maybe I might be wrong in some of the newer statistics. But if you look at France and Germany, Germany's largest component of produced power right now is through coal. They wanted to become anti-nuke. And right now, they've only reduced their carbon reductions by about something like 5%. Most of the time, when you have a renewable like wind or solar, you have to have a backup gas or some kind of other fossil fuel plant to back them up to produce steady power. France, on the other hand, in the early 80s, within 11 years, went from about 20% nuclear power to well over 90%. And they are the cheapest energy in Europe. They are the place where their air is cleaner, their water's cleaner, and the amount of carbon waste has been reduced, I don't remember the statistics right now, quite drastically. They run an all-electric based economy with their public transit, their home heat and everything else, and the waste they produced in just the last 30 years could be contained in this restaurant, and they use the extensive recycling of nuclear materials. Now, the only reason I came up and learned this stuff was I was actually looking at the evidence for nuclear power. And I'm also re-examining Andy's claims through his portal websites, through his 9/11 deals, and I'm finding it very convincing for his side, but I'm also looking at other sources. Amongst one of the biggest anti-nuclear activists, Helen Caldicott, for example, I've been finding a lot of what she said to be untrue. Like, for example, in Chernobyl, if you go back to the source documents, there was only about like 50 deaths from that accident. There has not been the massive cancers and massive leaks of radiation. Yes, there's a large area right now in the country that does have a radiation field, but people have gone back to it, they're living there now, and they're finding that the big devastating claims with some of this stuff has been absolutely false, and that a lot of the environmentalists who believe in this anti-nuclear stuff have been quite misled. Yes, I agree with Andy that you need to take a look at the evidence. Yes, you need to approach it with an open mind. But I look at the same evidence that Andy does, and I come up with a radically different conclusion. I'll leave it to you to decide.
My name is Dennis Nelson. Andy and I are mainstays in Chicago's Safer and Cleaner Energy Movement. It's been my pleasure to share the stage with Andy over the years, and I want to discuss the topic in greater detail that was more briefly covered in the birthday speaker's debate about what our energy future should be, April 18th of this year. This topic fits to a T Andy's theme about the information that John A. and Mary Q. Public are not getting from the news media. I agree with Andy that there is hope in creating a truly sustainable, more secure, healthier, and economically sound energy future without any fossil fuels and nuclear power, and is happening right now. Report: solar is cheaper than the grid in 42 of the 50 largest U.S. cities, and in all but 4 of the 50 cities, solar is a better investment than the stock market. This was posted on Green Tech Media, January 14th of this year, and this is a specialized green technology site. This is not the general news media that the vast majority of Americans get their information from. Millions of people living in cities where going solar would cost them less than their current utility rates, and most of them don't even know it. According to a new report by the North Carolina Clean Energy Technology Center, backed by the Sunshot Initiative, a fully financed solar PV system costs less than the energy purchased from a residential customer's local utility in 42 of the 50 largest cities in the United States. Among single-family homeowners in those 50 cities, the center estimates that 9.1 million live in a place where solar would be cheaper than their utility bill if they bought the system outright. Nearly 21 million would be better off going solar if low-cost financing is available. So there are facts, Tim, and there are also facts. Right now, buying an average-sized, fully financed solar PV system costs less than electricity from their local utility for 93% of single-family homeowners in America's 50 largest cities, and in most places is a better investment than many of the stocks that are in their 401k, unquote, said Jim Kennerly, project manager for the Going Solar in America report. Quote, nevertheless, most people are unaware that solar is this affordable for people of all walks of life, unquote. Many customers mistakenly think going solar requires having a lot of sunshine. The report points out that solar's value to the customer is more about how much grid energy it can offset. The center designed a ranking system for investing in solar in 50 cities using pricing data from the online solar quote service EnergySage. The analysis took into account three metrics: first year average monthly bill savings, the value investing in solar relative to a long-term investment indexed to the S&P 500 stock index, and the levelized cost of energy from a rooftop solar array. Now, here's a ranking of 50 largest cities based on where solar offers the best financial value, and the Windy City of Chicago ranks as solar city number 28. Electricity prices aren't likely to get any lower. The U.S. Energy Information Administration, EIA, forecasts that utility rates will rise between 33% and 83% over the next 25 years, the typical lifetime of a solar PV system. Meanwhile, there's been a rapid decline in the hardware costs for solar energy, which has made the technology much more accessible in all parts of the country. According to Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory in California, the median cost of a residential solar project fell from $12 per watt in 1988 to $4.70 per watt in 2013. Energy Sage reports that the average cost of a 5-kilowatt rooftop system in the third quarter of 2014, in the third quarter of 2014 before incentives, was as low as $3.70 per watt. In the third quarter of 2014, GTM Research found an even greater cost drop for turnkey residential systems of 5 kilowatts to 10 kilowatts, with an average of $3.60 per watt. Policies such as the federal investment tax credit, state renewable portfolio standards like we have here in Illinois, net metering like we have here in Illinois, and value of solar tariffs have helped to encourage more people to invest in solar, which in return has further reduced costs. Accounting for all of these factors, electricity prices, solar costs, relevant policies, etc., the report finds that customers in the most of the 50 largest cities would benefit from going solar. Some places will see significant savings up front. In Kansas City, for instance, residential solar customers can expect to save $57 per month in the first year of ownership. California residents can see even greater savings of up to $187 per month in that first year. The report finds that for many of America's 50 largest cities, the net present value of a dollar invested in solar, what the lifetime of the system is worth in today's dollars, is greater than a dollar invested in the stock market. Okay. Thank you very much.
Next.
Good summary, Dennis.
Next. Come on, we got the next rebutter going.
All right, come on. Come on,
you
gotta get up there. Let's go.
Yeah. Go ahead. Get on the chairs.
Thanks, Andy, for your information.
All right.
I think we have a problem with lack of information. We have a problem with the kind of government that we live under, as you all have heard me talk about ad nauseum. First, as Andy said, we should bring the troops home. Just one of many things he said we should do. Who is this we? We don't decide whether the troops come home or where they go and who they kill. The government decides that. And then shortly after that, he said, Andy said, the public should push our representatives. We should push our representatives. What does that mean? We're supposed to go to Congress and physically push whoever the hell my representative is, who I don't know because I don't care because it doesn't matter. Okay, well, what does this mean, push your representatives? These representatives answer to people with big money. They have self-interest. They have, they're megalomaniacs, half of them. They're greedy. Okay, they do not answer to us. In the next breath, Andy said that Congress is a house of intellectual whores. How can we have a house of intellectual whores, a government of intellectual whores, and expect them to do anything other than what whores do? Andy's great, okay, but these are common misconceptions or common ways of thinking about the situation that we live in that do not match up with reality. Andy said, if common sense prevailed, then we could transform our nation. Well, common sense does not prevail. That's the problem. Ordinary people have common sense. These megalomaniac oligarchs of ours do not have common sense. They are practically an alien species, okay, who do not care about us or the health of the planet or the good of humanity or any such good, nice things. And they also said that solutions are readily available with the spread of knowledge. Where do most people get their knowledge? There's just a plethora of garbage being spewed at them night and day, 24/7, from the mainstream media, okay? Just to give you an example, I drive around all day long because I drive a cab for a living, and unless I have a good radio in my car, I can't get the better stations that actually tell you what's going on. You just hear pure crap or shitty music all day long. One of the better stations is WCPT, 8:20 a.m. Some of you may be familiar with it, but it's hard to get. It has a weak signal, but I can usually get it. But if you really want to know what's going on, the best station that I've found is WNUR, 89.3, which has 1 3-hour program Saturday morning from 9 to 1 o'clock. That's where you would get the best information that you can get. But who knows about that, and who listens to it? Practically nobody. So the information that we need is very is in a small little area that is not readily available to most of the public. So what we need is actually government supporting good information, good media outlets. But the government is not going to do that because the government, as I just said, is not interested in the public welfare. So overall, generally speaking, what we need is a government of us, by us, for us, an actual democracy, which we don't have. That's our bigger problem. We live within a framework of a government that pervades our lives, determines everything, all the big policies in our lives, in every area, environmental, military, economic, every sort, educational, guns, everything, okay? The government determines all these things. We don't have shit to say about it. We don't determine that, because our government is a government of oligarchs, of plutocrats, of maniacs, of murderers, mass murderers, imperialists. And we have to get rid of that kind of government altogether and institute an actual democracy. Thank you.
Wow. All right, look at these guys. Now they're like, where are we?
Somebody was asking, you know, when I was making an announcement about a Bernie Sanders event, somebody made some remark about Obama being a socialist, and I said, oh, no, the Republicans say he's a socialist, he's not a socialist, but I was mistaken about that. It would be more accurate for me to say that some Republicans call Barack Obama a socialist, and many, you know, they don't all say that. Now I personally like Andy, I like his ideas about energy conservation and I to a great extent I agree with his politics, his views on what ought to be done. As probably a lot of you are already aware, where I disagree with him is not on opinions, but on facts. And now, what I've observed is that a lot of people don't understand the difference between fact and opinion. And this is why, for example, you say something like, okay, for example, the statement that the nuclear accident at Fukushima is an ongoing disaster of biblical proportions, that's not a fact, that's an opinion. What's biblical proportion mean? That definition is entirely in the eye of the beholder. If you said that there was X amount of radiation resulting from Fukushima, that would be a fact. So I think it's important to distinguish between facts and opinions. Now, the second thing, a lot of people don't understand the difference between evidence and proof. Now since I teach math and geometry, I do understand I like to think that I understand the difference between the evidence and proof. And it is possible, there is a difference. But proof means that it's been proven beyond a reasonable doubt. That's like you can prove that 2 + 2 = 4. But when you have evidence, let's say, for example, oh my gosh, there's a crime and you see somebody running away from the scene of the crime, you say, well, that's evidence that that person is guilty. But that's not proof that they're guilty. That doesn't prove it. So a lot of people don't understand. So when you hear people talk about overwhelming evidence, overwhelming evidence is not the same thing as proof. It means that there isn't proof, actually, in most cases. Now, people are not born knowing how to think logically and to think critically about things they read. But people can learn how to do it. It's something that has to be taught. Just like learning how to read and write, and learning math are things that have to be taught. Now, in my experience, there are a lot of people who Andy talked about people who can't face reality. In my experience, and I agree with him, I think there are a lot of people in the world who cannot face reality. That's one area where Andy and I definitely agree. Some of the reality that people seem unable to face is that there are terrorist groups like Al-Qaeda, that the people in these groups, like the late Osama bin Laden, do hate Americans, and that Osama bin Laden did declare war on the United States and said he was going to strike at American targets. That bin Laden bragged about being responsible for 9/11. And the fact that a group like Al-Qaeda can strike at the U.S. and in the right circumstances inflict incredible damage. Another bit of reality that a lot of people seem unwilling or unable to accept is that we actually were attacked by a foreign power, and not even a government foreign power, it's just a foreign terrorist organization, that we were attacked on 9/11. And then the third element that a lot of people seem unable to accept is that our government is not omnipotent. Our government does not have the power of Almighty God to make and create and do anything. Our government is run by human beings who, I am sorry to say, are as capable of error and screw-ups as anybody in this room.
Careful.
Now, and that is not a personal attack, Charlie. Now, the other question, I don't know how, is why would people, when you hear people talking about space aliens being among us, or the idea that AIDS is a myth, why would people believe such things? Well, I think, and I've been informed by our cameraman that my time is up, but I just want to conclude by saying that I think people believe it. People are inclined to believe these things, number one, because they just trust authorities. It's already been proven that authority figures, government, media, have lied in the past, and so people wonder what else have they lied about. So people become more inclined to believe people who say the government's lying, and then they put forth a theory on what really happened. Finally, people pick and choose those theories that they agree with. One person might believe that George Bush caused 9/11. Another person might believe that Obama's a Muslim communist from Kenya.
All right. Yeah. Your government doesn't make any mistakes, buddy.
I'm going to use
Bernie Norman.
I'm going to use my time partially to talk about Andy and his talk, and to rebut something Don Ritchie did in rebutting my rebuttal 2 weeks ago that I didn't have a chance to rebut then, so I'll rebut it now. But to start with, as usual, Andy, a great talk, well researched. You do your homework on all of this stuff. And while I do not agree with you on many of your conclusions, I think we need people like Andy who will, and I hate this cliche, but it really applies here. We need people who will think outside the box. And Andy certainly does this, okay? In fact, Andy sometimes thinks totally outside the building, which is good. Many of his specific claims and ideas and conclusions I have a little trouble with, and some of them may turn out to be baseless. But if only one or two of these turn out to be correct, in opposition to conventional thinking, he will have made an important contribution. I do have trouble with the notion of an occupied moon. I'm not so cynical as to believe in a medical conspiracy to kill AIDS patients, but I have been proven wrong before when I was the non-cynic. And as far as the 9/11 conspiracy, that seems very unlikely and very difficult to me to have pulled off, but there are still some unanswered questions about that whole thing. So all in all, I think Andy is doing a good job. We don't have to agree with him, but we should encourage him to continue to pursue his interests and pursue some of the truths that may be hidden on all of these issues. Now, regarding Don, actually this is a topic that kind of relates because we talked about climate change and the environment a couple weeks ago, and at that time I suggested that the very best and most important way to save the planet, to protect the environment, is to reduce population. In fact, the only way in the long run is to reduce population, because we can save energy all these different ways that Andy's been talking about and other ways. But nonetheless, with the population of the Earth growing, and most importantly, people in other parts of the world are going to become middle class and want the things that we have, cars, refrigerators, TV sets, etc., all of which use lots of energy, and the industry uses lots of energy. At some point, it will become untenable. I don't think the world, well, we know that the world can't support 8 or 10 billion people on Western lifestyles. And in fact, some experts have said that the Earth can support only 1 billion people on Western lifestyles. That's a key issue. There's maybe only 1 billion people now who live what we would call Western lifestyles. So we need to reduce population. Now, I suggested that something like this would have to be compulsory. China's the only country that is doing it, and they're being lobbied by many places, including the United States, to end this. It's called a terrible, and it's called a human rights disaster, etc., etc. They're the only ones who seem to want to save the planet. And Don pointed out, when I made the statement, I also made the statement that this would be incredibly difficult to do politically and sociologically, because we consider it a natural right above all rights to have as many babies as we want, regardless of what that might do to the planet. And it would be very, very difficult. China's a dictatorship, and they're having difficulty doing it, okay? And they're getting pressure not to do it. So how would the rest of the world do it? I don't know. It's a very difficult problem. But if we don't voluntarily reduce population, I think population will be reduced by Mother Nature with pestilence and starvation and so on and so forth, or more likely with wars. Initially civil wars and then eventually worldwide wars over the resources needed to support these lifestyles. And so there will be a tragedy one way or the other. Better if we control it administratively, but that would be very, very difficult. And Don attempted to point that out, that in China they have some bans that would be very unpopular here. And I see if I get these right, Don. Number one is no sex out of marriage.
Right.
Number two, you got to have a permit to get married.
Yep, that's right.
Number three, you have to have a permit to have a child. And what was our fourth one?
The government practices forced abortion.
Okay. All right. Those four things. As far as no sex before marriage, I disagree with the Chinese on that, and not that it's doing me much any good to disagree with it now, but I do disagree. As far as the permit to get married, well, we have that here too. We call it a marriage license, and we don't, they're not as strict as that. And then the other one, as far as having permits to have kids, no, we don't have that here. I think what we need is to take natural people who want to have a natural baby.
And you do not have a permit to go overtime.
What?
You do not have a permit to go overtime.
Okay. Nonetheless, if we have a civil war here, I'll deal with that, okay? I just got a couple more things. Yeah, well, I know, Charlie, I'm not as smart as you are, but, that's the way it is at the college.
We have to.
It does. We were talking about the environment.
Wrap it up.
I'm trying, and everybody's hassling me. Okay, so as far as what I think we should do is if people want to have a baby, they should go through the same procedures that people who want to adopt a baby have before they can have a baby. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, let's thank our speaker. And for bringing all this wonderful stuff here. By the way, regarding the public policy of population of China, the United States has not had the problems this nation has faced. And yes, they are serious about population control, and they're not discussing rights anymore about this. These are serious issues. They've had millions of people die of famine, illness. This is no joking around. They've got to face problems. It may not be nice, but yeah, that's the way it is. All right, correction. You announced the Bernie Sanders thing for Wednesday, but that's in my our part of town. There's ones all over the city, I think. You go to the website and put in your zip code. The one he gave is the Southsiders. But you may find one closer to your house if you go there.
I got that one off of Facebook.
Yeah.
I thought I'd let everybody else.
Yeah, but people can look up their one nearest their house. That's all. You put in your zip code, and the whole list comes up. Arlington Heights and everything. All right. If you want to dealing with epidemics and infectious diseases, I've been a member of the United Nations Association for over a quarter century, an officer of the local chapter. I would rely on the United World Health Organization here regarding what's going on in combating illnesses across the world. I discovered in researching this, the only ones who were disputing it were the alternative medicine crowd. We book a lot of alternative medicine speakers here, and they were selling products allegedly to strengthen the immune system. This would take care of HIV/AIDS. These were basically worthless, and they were taking advantage of people, and it's big money there. Not that I'm a big friend of Big Pharma. I know all about Big Pharma. But just this old mantra of, you strengthen your immune system. We had it here at the college. The guy wasn't feeling well. And there were a couple of guys here, this alternative medicine crowd, and they told him to eat broccoli. So he's eating broccoli like he wouldn't believe. And then they discovered it wasn't working. So they started researching, and then they said, you've been eating cooked broccoli. It has to be raw broccoli. That's why it wasn't working here. Regarding the thing there, we had that other speaker here, Joanne, many years ago regarding Fukushima, and really I've been following that, giving these nuke boys a hard time on that. But I still remember she gave me some literature that she said nobody died of radiation poisoning. She was from Argonne, but she gave me this literature proving, it was like five-page article she wrote, that nobody at Hiroshima or Nagasaki died of radiation poisoning. You know, it was just completely bizarre. Now, regarding censorship in the media, there's got to be some apparatus that enforces censorship from the top to the bottom. The media has, 1,000 outlets here in Chicago? Is the media controlled? You're darn right. Having worked in it many, many years in a PR capacity, every reporter has a story or a press release that was killed. And I've got several myself. Was I happy about it? No. Did I have some words with the editor or the publisher or the PR chief? You're darn right I did. Now, the most amazing thing about this was I was confronted with a situation where I was going out with a really attractive young lady for quite a while who was a reporter for the Philadelphia Inquirer. And she came to me quite irate and upset because her editor killed her great expose story, which I'd been meaning to tell her for about a month or two. It was the craziest fucking story I ever heard. And I could totally agree with him. And I don't know why he hadn't done it sooner. But I kept quiet.
considering I wanted to pursue our relationship. But yes, there's no over-operating apparatus. You have to, so many media operates independently. But yes, the editors control stories, yes they do. Do they make their own value judgments? Are they totally objective? No, they're not, obviously not. And there's all sorts of variables that go into that. But that's basically it. Thank you very much. And really, the other thing is we've got to watch out for these drugs. I'm really suspect, I keep paying attention to this, the drugs that are advertised on television. We had that speaker here not long ago. Now, there are regular pharmaceuticals that are advertised. She spoke about that. I don't really care for that. The other one is, I found one just the other day. They were selling this thing, and if you find out, it's nothing but pumpkin seeds. Now, if you think this pumpkin seed is going to cure what ails you, the best of luck. But thank you very much. By the way, we got a literature table here, so help yourself. Thanks, Andy.
So, do you have any other rebuttals? In that case, Andy, you're on.
Okay, I'm coming right now.
Okay, Andy.
Oh,
you've got about,
that's good.
Go ahead.
8 minutes or something?
12, actually.
Yeah. Try to quickly address a couple of the comments here. I agree with Tim where he says you have to have an open mind to look at some things. What I would suggest, if you read any of the... You look at any of the books that are currently available talking about climate change. This one was written by Elizabeth Colbert. It's called The Sixth Extinction. The world is in the sixth major extinction, losing species because of ocean pollution, global warming, climate change, ocean becoming more acid, is it? Acidification. The one single fact you have to look at is how fast global warming and climate change is happening, how solid the science is, and how much time we have to get a crash program started to stop burning fossil fuel. If you look at the time frame we have to cut down massively on fossil fuel, nuclear power can play no part in that solution. The next generation of nuclear power plants won't be here in time to cut into fossil fuels to make any difference whatsoever, the time frame. Talking about the next generation of nuclear power plants being a solution is like talking about an emergency room doctor that is, a victim comes in with an accident, the lawnmower blade cut an artery in their leg, and the doctor says, well, I have a blood clotting agent we're working on that'll stop that bleeding. It'll be ready in 2 years. Well, the patient's going to bleed to death in the next 10 minutes if somebody doesn't take appropriate action. That's the way it is with climate change and nuclear power. Climate change will be an issue that's done and settled with the ice melting and the sea levels coming up 60 feet in this century, 20 meters they're talking about, a massive displacement of people living, 70% of the world's population lives near the oceans. You know, they're talking about moving inland. Huge disruption before nuclear power, the next generation can make any contribution whatsoever. And if you look at the money that it takes to build a nuclear power plant, if you spend an equal amount of money on the technologies we've talked about here today that are already here, and today's solar panels cost a third per megawatt of what a nuclear power plant would cost. Just on the sheer economics alone, you'd put up solar panels,
And also, you can probably get 20 times as more energy from solar in the time that it would take to one build one nuke. So there's no debate that solar energy, solar and wind power are the way to go. And there's a... I had a book here. There's a book around here. Let me hold this one up, because it's worth ordering a copy. The book that addresses this issue is written by Danny Kennedy. It's called Rooftop Revolution, how solar power can save our economy and our planet from dirty energy. Rooftop Revolution, it's happening now. As Dennis pointed out, in 42 out of the top 50 cities, solar energy is cheaper than nuclear utility electricity right now. I want to thank Dennis for providing a lot of the information update that I didn't have time to talk about. As you look into the evidence of the total energy efficiency revolution, the numbers that some people are getting from some sites are off by a factor of 1,000. To say that solar and wind power can only make a small contribution is probably the grossest perversion of the English language that it's possible to make. We are bathed in energy from wind and solar. And wind and solar today is the fastest growing source of energy on the planet, along with wind, because they're also the cheapest and cleanest. Those are facts you can look up from the actual numbers of how, when you hear somebody say solar and wind can only make a small contribution, that's government produced, fossil fuel produced propaganda. It's outright propaganda, and you have to be able to see through it. I agree with Ted on a lot of things, I would go a little farther. I agree with Ted totally that our paid prostitutes masquerading as our elected politicians don't represent us. Collectively, we as a human race have responsibility to do something to push solutions forward. It's up to us from the grassroots up. If that means changing our government, as Naomi Klein talks about, a non-violent revolution to get rid of the criminals that are running our system and build a new system that helps promote beneficial technologies, food production, everything else across the board, for the entire planet, that's what it means. Each of us has a small responsibility. Collectively, millions of us, if we poured $5 a piece into something constructive, we could get something done. But that's the problem when we allow ourselves to be misled by the media and kept in a bubble thinking that we're all isolated and alone and there's nothing we can do, so it's all a big failure. We can't allow ourselves to think like that. We have to think in terms of what can we do that's constructive, and is the way I look at it, the first step is helping people learn what things are constructive and what aren't. And a lot of you may remember, we've come a long way. 30 years ago, you could get into a fist fight in a restaurant like this if you asked somebody to put out their cigarette next to you. Today, we have smoke-free restaurants. Scientific beneficial knowledge usually moves forward in the direction of truth, and when 98% of the public accepts something, then it's considered accepted. We move forward and we tackle another problem. Incidentally, the World Health Organization put out a report in 2008 saying that the what they were calling a heterosexual AIDS epidemic is over. There is no heterosexual AIDS epidemic anywhere but in Africa. They're still promoting the myth that there's AIDS in Africa when those people have malnutrition, malaria, tuberculosis. You can take the bogus HIV test over there, and virtually everybody in Africa is going to test HIV positive. That's how the lawsuits are coming up through the courts against the test manufacturers, like they did against asbestos and tobacco. It just takes time for the lawsuits to spell out the magnitude of the fraud, and that's where we're headed. One of the things that I have difficulty, I've had discussions with Don over, you know, Don is very knowledgeable on certain subjects, and on the ones that he's very knowledgeable on, if I have the same body of knowledge and have studied the same things and it's reality, we agree. But we disagree on some things where Don hasn't studied the evidence. And this has been going on for years. And so my suggestion would be to, you're absolutely right, there's a difference between evidence and proof. And once you examine evidence from different sources, credible sources, peer-reviewed sources that are backed by hundreds of scientists, that evidence becomes more than just a theory or an unsubstantiated opinion. Like the evidence we have showing that cigarette smoking is not good for the health of young people if they smoke 4 packs a day. There's no debate on that. That's considered a fact. It's not considered a theory anymore because the evidence is so overwhelming. There's a growing body of evidence that shows that the mercury preservatives, a thing called thimerosal, in vaccines is directly related to the rise in autism in young children in this country. Now, and among the scientists that study this, there's no debate. But yet, the pharmaceutical industry and the vaccine manufacturers have enough money to run ads or produce reports. If you hear 1,000 minutes of one opinion versus 1 minute of truth, it's very hard to sort through what's true and what isn't. All I would suggest I like Ernie's presentation, but if you have unanswered questions on a subject where the questions have already been answered, then are we having a problem in the back room there?
Sorry.
A man named George Wald wrote the introduction to Ernest Sternglass's book, Secret Fallout. I think it was 1983 that was published. I was thumbing through it, some of the old anti-nuclear books, and George said, you know, a lot of people complain that they have problems with Ernest's numbers and statistics. And George said, that complaint would impress me if I found any scientist that didn't have a problem with other scientists' numbers. That's the way it is. He said, Ernest has an exuberant way with the numbers, but it looks like he has a very strong case. And it is, as you look at more and more of the numbers, once you begin to examine it with an open mind, it becomes easier and easier to understand what these scientists are saying. And that's why I produced, you know, these flyers. There's one up here that says tip of the iceberg, and the other one is documented facts. Those facts are basically, those 10 facts we listed tonight, are documented by a massive amount of peer-reviewed, published evidence from highly credible sources all over the planet. But yet, none of these things are really talked about in the American media so that people have a chance to learn what the sources are or where the evidence even comes from. That's why you have to look to the alternative media and alternative sources, and if you find a really credible source, usually they will be linked to other credible sources. And that's what we do. And also, several people have expressed the fact that what I'm talking about here is Andy's opinion. They don't understand that I'm a translator. I translate the database. If you have a problem with one of the things that I said, then write a letter to the man or the group of people with the Nobel Prizes that worked on that for 30 years. It's not my opinion. It's a database. Like, it's not my opinion that smoking three packs a day is not good for your health. That's published data going back 30 years. Same thing with asbestos. Same thing with depleted uranium. It's not my opinion that depleted uranium dust is contaminating people in Iraq. That's documented by radiation experts all over the world. And all I did was provide a summary, you know, give you the basic facts in a short amount of time. So there's never enough time to answer everybody's questions here, but we do the best we can, and hope that you will take the list of references and sources with you. Incidentally, this, if everybody can see this, kind of like a wicker basket that holds flyers, these are some of our top 10 flyers starting back in 1989. And none of the facts we listed as blacked out facts, none of those things has gone in the direction of being disapproved. None of the things we've reported as a translation of database reality has done anything but become more and more solid accepted reality as the iceberg of evidence just got bigger and more widely published over the last 30 years. So that's why I have the confidence in saying that these things are facts, because I've been working with this kind of database translation technique for almost 40 years now. And after a while, you learn where the credible sources are, who's credible and who's not. So if nobody has any other questions, we'll wrap it up there.
Hold on, Andy.
You see, even though me and Andy may disagree about quite a bit of things, we do agree on one thing. I have a gray 2006 Scion XP. So does Andy has a gray 2006 Scion XP. It's one of the most economical cars. I, too, get about 35 miles to the gallon. I got a quarter million miles. How many do you got?
I got 80,000, or 170,000, 180,000.
It's still one of the most reliable vehicles around.
Right? We have the same vehicle, basically, and that's one of the things we agree on.
So I have to start by
If anybody wants any other literature that wasn't handed out, come up here and get whatever you want while we're wrapping it up, okay?